the session of the topics 1 to 8 of the REVUSA SHWA 2021 is starting. Introducing briefly myself, I'm Domenico Pessina, a professor of the University of Milan. Many of you are knowing me from time. And today we will have 12 presentations. Probably all the authors and speakers are present, dealing with 7 of the 8 topics included in the all the topics, the entire topics of the REVUSA SHWA. So we can start with the presentation. Some presentation will be through a video. So I suppose that the video is respecting the limit of 10 minutes that we indicated to the authors. Other presentations will be presented directly by one of the authors of the paper. We can start so with topic 2. Just an advisement. An advisement is that the presentation that will be presented by a speaker in this presentation, after 8 minutes, we will have a warning that 2 minutes are left to conclude the presentation. Okay, and this warning will be carried out by Elio Romano with a special sound of him coming from Elio. Okay, so we can start the series of presentation with topic 2. Topic 2 is work-related musculoskeletal disorders. The presentation is entitled Image Analysis for Ergonomic Risk Assessment for Rope Arborists by Massimo Cecchini, Andrea Colantoni, Danilo Monarca, Filippo Cossio, Francesco Mazzocchi and Leonardo Bianchini. They told me that Leonardo Bianchini will present through a video this paper. So Leonardo, the floor is yours. You can manage the video directly, or if prefer, Massimo is managing, I suppose, Leonardo.
Hello, everyone. I would like to present one of the work of a research group entitled Image Analysis for Ergonomic Risk Assessment for Rope Arborists. Tree climbing is a technique that originated in the United States at the beginning of the 20th century and gradually spread to the other countries. It allows access to the tree canopy with equipment without having to use machines. It is mainly used for pruning, felling, stability assessment and consolidation. Tree climbers are exposed to a wide range of risks, including falling from the height, risk of cutting both the operator himself and the equipment securing him to the plant, force of impact at the moment of arrest of the fall, withdrawal syndrome, unfavorable weather condition, falling objects that may be equipment or part of the plant, communication difficulties between operators, unintentional contact with live part of power line, dangerous insects and animals, and last but not least, the ergonomic risk. Ergonomic risk is also a very important factor in this work sector, as the operator performs demanding physical work and often in positions that are not perfectly vertical, having to rely on ropes to maintain a stable position. The arborist finds himself cutting with saws and chainsaws, repeating movement and postures that have never been objectively assessed to quantify the associated risk. The aim of the work was to apply existing indices to assess posture and quantify the risk associated with the tree climbing work activities. The work site where the pruning activities were carried out are 2 chestnut groves located on Mount Cimino in the province of Viterbo. 3 operators were needed for the survey, one on the ground to assist and rescue the worker, therefore qualified to climb trees and trained to recover the injured person, and an operator in the canopy equipped with a camera to film adapted operator for pruning. The equipment used was a usually tree climbers equipment, which referred to the provision of the consolidated law of safety in the workplace, legislative degree 8108, and consists of access and positioning device, personal protection equipment, and end and power cutting tool such as hacksaw, telescopic poles, and chainsaw. The access system to the workplace was made by choosing a branch that was sufficiently high but with an optimal diameter and condition to support the operator. Using a special sling, a bag attached to a line is drawn over and over the side branch. The bag returns to the ground by gravity, making the line follow the exact path of the access rope. If necessary, adjustment can be made to perfect path. Then the sling was replaced with the rope, the ascending end of which was inserted into a descender device, which was in turn attached to an anchor device, as per the guideline. Once of the highest position has been reached with a single rope technique, the operator secures himself with a safety lanyard mount the work rope. A double rope technique, not directly on the branch, but through change safe webbing. He then disengages from the single rope system with which he has ascended and is ready to move inside the canopy, reaching the branches to be removed or which to make the return cut. Each time he has to make cut, the operator secures himself with the lanyard for double safety. The choice of the index must be made according to the type of work, so that it takes into account the limb most subject to strain repetitive rather than impulsive work. After the accurate bibliography research, no specific index emerged for the evaluation of ergonomic risk of rope worker. So it was decided to use two well-established indexes for postural analysis, RIBA and RULA. Both indices consist of calculation matrices that, depending on the posture assumed by operators, return a score that increases according to the lack of ergonomic during work. The RIBA index allows the postural assessment of the risk due to the musculoskeletal disorder of upper limb and neck. The RIBA method is an international user method that allows the quantity analysis of the main risk factor due to which a worker may be subject. The method is to be used in a context of general postural assessment. The fundamental output of RIBA method being the identification working condition that could lead to a serious pathologies in workers. The RULA index was developed to investigate exposure to upper limb musculoskeletal risk during work. RULA was developed by assessing the postures adopted and the force required for operation during work. The video analysis was carried out using ErgoFellow 3.0, with which the ergonomic indices RIBA index and RULA index were calculated. The postures of tree workers engaged in pruning tall trees using the tree climb techniques were analyzed from an ergonomic point of view. 100 observations were taken into consideration. The RIBA and RULA index was calculated from each of them. From the analysis of the data, it emerges the diversity of the process of calculating and weighing the different postures according to the risk class, despite the fact that the maximum values are different, therefore the average between the two indices are different. The final data place the operator into different risk classes, medium with necessary action for RIBA and further investigation and rapid application or change necessary for RULA. Also, the distribution of the value obtained is substantially different, which confirms what is underlined by Pearson coefficient and covariance coefficient, both close to zero. The two indices are not interchangeable but return a different level of risk for the same task. It is clear from the distribution plot that the RIBA index, which considers the whole body, gives average value on the risk scale for the type of rope pruning work, while RULA, which only considers the upper part of the body, gives an almost always high risk value. In order to have a subject term of comparison as to which of the two indices is more appropriate, a third sample of, was introduced, i.e. all the images were assessed by six experienced operators who give an opinion by assigning a value from 1 to 11 according to their personal opinion of the ergonomics of the postures. This sample is considered a useful comparison as it is expressed by people who are expert in the type of work. In order to compare the three sets of data, the indices were normalized and compared graphically, and the covariance between RIBA and RULA value and those provided by the experience operator was calculated. The analysis of covariance returned a more similar value between RULA index and the value assigned by expert operator, although the risk level is more similar to the RIBA index value. In conclusion, image analysis proved to be extremely useful for analyzing data on the posture of a rope work pruning. Thanks to the system, it has been possible to collect a good quantity of postures and analyze them at the later stage, thanks to dedicated software that allow for more precise examination, which would otherwise be analyzed quickly and in field. The result confirmed that two indices, RIBA and RULA, were not designed to analyze rope work. In fact, the risk value are neither similar nor covariant. For a more conservative evaluation, it would be advisable to use RULA, which returns a higher value and suggests looking for solutions to improve the ergonomics of the operator works. On other hand, the distribution of the value within quartile is much more similar between RIBA and experiences operator. In conclusion, it is desirable to have a specific index for ropeway workers, taking into account working postures and equipment, which is necessary also positively influenced by harnesses and positioning rope. This work laid a foundation for the development of such an index of risk for ropeway workers.
Okay, thank you, Leonardo. Thank you to all the authors for this interesting presentation about a very important item about the work on tall trees, rope work. A brief question to Leonardo or other authors by me. RIBA and RULA are indexes that are not completely good for a good evaluation for rope work. Are you studying new indices that may be a combination of the two or a new one in order to evaluate better rope work or not? Who of the author are able or want to answer?
Thank you for the question. Other indices that we studied are not suitable for the work activity. For example, NIOSH is based on lifting. Another reason was the richer literature for RULA and RIBA. Actually, RULA and RIBA would not be suitable either, but we evaluated them better than others. And for your question, we haven't studied at the moment a specific index.
Thank you very much for the answer. I think in the future it will be useful to study specific index for rope work because, of course, the rope work is increasing in importance and diffusion.
Thank you.
Okay, if there is no other live questions, I should pass to the next topic of this session, topic three, machine milking, animal welfare, sustainable livestock farming. We have two presentations. I suppose both of them are presented live because I'm seeing Cinzia Marchitelli for
Yes,
the first
I.
presentation in this topic and also David Merzilio for the second one. Okay, thank you. So you confirm that you will present live?
Yes, I present live and now I share with you my presentation.
Okay, David is the same. The microphone, David.
Yes, I
Okay,
confirm
okay.
live.
So, okay. The next presentation, the next paper is entitled Using of NMR Milk Metabolomics to Evaluate Mammary Gland Health Status in Varicose. Is presented by Cinzia Marchitelli. Cinzia, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I explain you some results, preliminary results, about using of NMR analysis to detect some metabolite to evaluate mammary gland health status in varicose. Milk is an important food, important for the newborn of all mammalian species, but is important for the growth of child, but also important for the adult. Milk contains 18 of the 22 essential nutrients and it has many physiological functionalities. For milk, it's important to study milk quantity and milk quality, and the quantity and quality are affected by different physiological and environmental factors. Example, disease or estrus and pregnancy or different breed, different species, or temperature or altitude or season of calving. Now I'm interested in factors for milk quality. These one are the four important factors for milk quality: microbiological quality, antibiotic residues, milk composition, and somatic cell count. In this presentation, I explain and focus about somatic cell count. Somatic cell count is a global parameter used in dairy industry to detect an important dairy disease as mastitis. Mastitis is an inflammation of the mammary gland and is a disease that has an important economic implication in the dairy industry. This inflammation is caused by different bacteria, by different pathogenic microorganisms. Mastitis causes the different physical, chemical, and bacteriological change in milk, and its incidence is principal in intensive farm. Somatic cell count is a pool of different kinds of cells, epithelial cells and different immunoresponse cells. And this parameter is important to detect a mammary gland infection. In European Union, this parameter has a limit 400,000 cells per milliliters. It's important that managing practice and the selection for mastitis resistance phenotypes are conventional methods to control this disease in dairy farm. The objective of this study is propose the use of milk metabolites as indicator of mammary gland health status. These results are a little part of a big project funded by Ministry of Agriculture, Migualac project, and the aim of this project is the improvement of nutritional milk quality. This is the experimental design sampling of Migualac. We use four breeds. Three breeds present in our farm in Monterotondo, Simmental, Osten, and the cross Simmental for Osten, and there are farmed in intensive system. The other breed is a Podolica breed, is a local breed in the south of Italy, and it is farmed in extensive system. We collected two samples, the two points of lactation. Milk samples were analyzed to detect different phenotype as metabolized by NMR. We analyzed 44 milk morning samples, and the NMR signal have been assigned using the human and the bovine metabolome database. We divide the milk samples using the somatic cell count in healthy and non healthy. At first, for statistic analysis, we use a package of Statistica 12, named the data mining analysis, to reduce the amount of data. We use a reduced data set for a GLM procedure in the same software. Results. We obtain 400 bin. After data mining analysis, we have 40 bin as the best predictor for somatic cell count class. And we assign the bin to a metabolite for only 20 bin. This is an example of the spectra we obtain by the NNMR analysis. We confirmed some metabolites that are present in other studies where using milk, were compared the high versus low somatic cell count or early versus late lactation. But we obtain also four new metabolites in this study. So I conclude that 12 metabolites resulted statistically significant different in milk of healthy versus non-healthy mammary gland. 8 of 12 are being detected in other studies. 4 of the 12 are novel and are associated with high somatic cell count. So in this study, we discovered and confirmed the indicators for mammary health. So the NMR metabolomic analysis is a potent tool for a better understanding of milk quality, and some metabolites could be used as biomarker of mammary gland status. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Cinzia, for your presentation. I must confess that this item is outside my direct knowledge, so I'm not able to give you some sort of to make some questions. So if other people that are attending have questions to Cinzia, please, this is the moment, this is the time. I do not hear any voice. Monica Parlato is writing great presentation. Thank you, Cinzia, again. No other chat, no other comments in chat. So I think that it's time to pass to the other presentation for these topics. The title is Precision Livestock Farming for Milk, a look inside the Buffalo sub-project by David Meozilio, that is presenting, Gennaro Catillo, Vittoria Barile, Antonella Chiariotti, Miriam Iacurto, Roberto Steri, Francesca Cenci, Maria Chiara Lamantia and Luca Buttazzoni. David, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for your introduction. And so let's go to the point. My speech will not very technical. It's rather an overview of an important activity we are doing at CREA within the sub-project Digital Technologies in Cow and Buffalo Milk Supply Chain, acronym PLF for Milk. That's a branch of a wider project, namely AgriDigit, wandering into digital agriculture from forestry to agrimeteorology, cropping, and obviously livestock production. That's our issue. The whole duration was 3 years, but 18 months extension has been granted owing mainly to COVID-19 emergency. So funds were 780,000 for research, euros for research, and 700,000 for equipment. Working package 4 of the sub-project deals with precision livestock production in the buffalo species through two different tasks: production behavior and welfare of lactating buffaloes, and the study of methane emission. This is our station, okay? And the background was that there are more or less 500,000 buffalo in Italy, 90% of the European population, out of 200 million heads worldwide, mainly located in disadvantaged areas. Local or marginal spread may have induced an underestimation of its potential, its real potential, and perhaps a gap in technology, in particular if compared to dairy cattle. The aim of this work package was to increase the efficiency of buffalo farms, and the activity addresses this need, along with welfare and sustainability improvement. Okay, our team skills and specific aims of the sub-project that are development of breeding and feeding protocol to ensure a higher welfare according buffalo, according in particular to thermal stress, and individual measurement of methane emission also for selective purposes. The rationale of the project of the working package is reported in this slide. So two tasks, one dealing with behavior, welfare and production, and the other with emission, and all data will be processed and correlated and integrated in the last step to drive selection, to make up protocols, and to release application software. To date, we are more or less a little more than halfway through the project. In other words, we have a sensor tools panel represented by BOLI for reproduction, production, and economic indexes. Data logger for temperature and humidity index calculation. The zoometer for automatic and remote acquisition of body condition score, and ear tag sensor system for registering activity, resting, rumination, ear temperature, and in time to get information about nutrition, health, and reproduction. And the laser methane pistol for methane concentration. We have also available a validation or correlation tool set, such as blood samples for oxidation stress markers and so on. We perform objective evaluation of body condition score and the rectal temperature. And we do direct and indirect rumen sampling. And we will perform also metagenomics in order to characterize the rumen population. Obviously, a robust statistic and informatic tool set is crucial to target our objective. Oh, sorry. I would like to show you some evidences from task one and task two. Starting from task one, I want to comment this slide where I reported the eating activity according to the season. We have on the right the month of the year, January, July, August, and so on. And you can easily see that buffalo seems to strongly concentrate their eating activity, their presence at manger over the highest temperature periods. July, August, while in the rest of the year, or during the mild or cold season, this cue seems to be more regular and I would say flatter. This evidence could suggest that even though buffalo is often supposed to be a very well adapted species to hot climatic condition, it is in reality sensitive to some extent and modify its behavior accordingly. The body condition score evaluation by specialized operators is used to calibrate, validate, and update the zoometer for distance measurement, and also to validate, update, and calibrate the multiple regression equation for objective body condition measurement. In the next slide, I show you the results of the two aforementioned methods of measurement. The green line is the body condition score acquisition by operator, and the red one is the same measurement get from the electronic device. And even when distance seems to be sidereal, the deviation is minor or equal than alpha point in a ninth scale point. So the results are quite similar. As for task two, we use the laser methane detector to get information on methane emission by directly pointing the laser beam into the muzzle of animals during normal or regular managing activity, such as milking. And in this graph, you can see the difference between the signal, the emission over the normal respiration, and the peaks deriving from other events, for instance, eructation. The next one, I reported the results of a 1 minute measurement over 3 days, twice per day, for 10 animals. And you can see again the difference between respiration and other situation. And it's quite evident high variability there is within and between animals. So as preliminary conclusion and remarks, I would say that sensor approach to buffalo farming may lead to optimization of management. I mean, feeding, milking, grouping, and so on, according to specific needs, behavior, and animal-based responses. Methane emissions seem to be very variable and so viable for selection. Irritability was 0.15 in dairy cattle, and what about buffalo, for example? And lastly, the use of technology can help to safety manage the herds. We saw the remote acquisition of body condition score, but body weight is also possible. And to improve buffalo farming efficiency by preventing heat stress, nutrition, and fertility problems through the development of an easy to use application software for stakeholders. Sorry. So, as next future challenges, I would mention calibration and validation of ear tag sensor for buffalo as algorithms are now developed for dairy cattle. The validation of laser methane detector for quantitative methane emission measurement in buffalo, and the selection based on lower emission and higher resilience to climate change. Thank you very much for your attention, and should you have any questions, please contact me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David, for your presentation. Some questions live, because I am seeing nothing in the chat. I have one, David, very quick, but on a general view. Methane emission for dairy cattle cows in particular, I've studied, and I heard different results and different ideas about it. The question is about buffalo. Are the difference the touch ball big, light, or we have to study them?
So I suppose, but it is quite evident that there are differences between buffalo and cattle. If you mean to have some such a question, an answer. Obviously, as I told you before, the big part of the literature deals with dairy cattle, and so buffalo, the buffalo wolves has to be studied in depth in order to provide clear and strong results in this sense. We know methane emission depends on a lot of factors, such as species, obviously, and also feeding, managing, environmental condition. It's a topic to be studied intensively in the next few years.
Thank you. Thank you very much, David. You can stop, you can close the sharing of your video. If there are no more questions or remarks, I'm saying that in the program there are no papers about topic 4, so we can pass directly to topic 5. Topic 5 is instrumentation, equipment, and periodic procedure and tests. We have two papers. The first one of the two is entitled Contribution of Inspection Methods to Monitoring Operator Comfort During Agricultural Operation by Elio Romano, Carlo Bisaglia, Roberto Oberti, Aldo Calcante, Alberto Zani, Denis Vinikov, Andrea Marconi, Ermanno Vitale, Massimo Bracci e Venerando Rapisarda. I suppose that Carlo Bisaglia is presenting this paper. Carlo, to you.
Yes, thank you very much, Mimmo. Oh, I will try to share the monitor. Okay, thank you very much and good afternoon to everybody. I will present this work that was made mainly by the other co-author, but the group is very big because we have used the different professions, different skills, different ability. We are in the group agronomists, engineers, also physicians. And the idea was to combine different methods to assess the comfort of the operator during driving a tractor with different driving methods. So the introduction of this paper is very simple because all has changed in the last few years. Changes in tractor design and use, changes in farms, in farmers' role and organization. We have a bigger farm and the digital divide between farmers is a rising issue. There are changes in agricultural operation. We have bigger farm, we have an increasing share in the operation conducted in road condition. The transport is very important. And also we have changes in the consideration and in the acceptability of well-being and health by the farmers. So now is very important also the comfort in the decision to buy a tractor. So the comfort is become quite like a performance of the tractor. So for this reason, it is important also to assess the condition of comfort provided by a tractor to the drivers. So we have tried to analyze the new possibility, the quite new possibility of driving automatically a tractor. So in this project, we have used one tractor that was possible to be driven in three methods, manually, as tradition, with a satellite-assisted system. That means that the driver uses the wheeling steer, but the direction is provided by the satellite system that provide the guideline on the monitor, and a semi-automatic mode that is called the semi-automatic because it is not used during the turnings of the tractor at the headland of the field. We have used 10 operators. The operators were all male, right-handed, remember this detail, young, with about the same body size, with experience in driving tractors. And we have used a tractor with a RTK system, and the operation that we have carried out was simply an harrowing field. So with the three replication for each condition, we finally have 90 observations for this experiment, but all the details are reported in this paper if you want to deep in the methodology. The expression methods that we have used, the sensor array and the expected output. Firstly, we have used a system, a MET, provided with the resistive sensors to measure the barometry of the body on the seat. So in other words, we detect the weight transmitted by the driver to the seat during the time. So the expected output was the specific weight on the seat. And we have also the dynamic map of the weight of the driver on the seat during work. The second method that we have used was the surface electromyography, because we would like to measure the muscular activation during driving. As you can see, we have used four sensors, and it is important to observe the position of the sensor, both the shoulders the left arm, because we have supposed that a right hand driver uses the left arm to drive the tractor, and on the vertebral column. The last sensor used was directed to analyze the posture of the driver, and we have used a three-dimensional camera, a commercial device that is normally used for the video games, that is the Kinect, the second version. And this device is able to take picture of the main 25 joints of the human body in order to produce a movement skeleton of the body. So we have not used all these 25 joints, but only four. And also in this case, I ask you to remember this detail, because we have used the joint 3 and 4, neck and head, and the two shoulders, neck joint 5 and 9. So the test ground, very, very simple situation. We have selected the field, regular, planned. The only problem was the quantity of stones in the field, because they can affect the vibration of the tractor. We have divided the field in three parts, and in each of these parts, we have used a different driving system. So manual, satellite assisted in the second part of the field, and semi-automatic. Every driver have to perform this schema of work, but we have decided to eliminate from the measurements the turning, because this part is common of the three methods used. So we have recorded only the working the straight line. The result. The first one deals with the speed. Very simple, here in false color from the telemetry of the tractor, we have recorded the average speed. So as you can see, the semi-automatic system has provided the significantly higher speed compared with the other modes. This is a very good result from a performance point of view. But what about the comfort? This is a question that we have tried to answer in the other elaboration. In fact, if you see the barometric system, that means the weight transmitted on the seat by the driver, we have here the three method, and in the column we have the average weight, the maximum, the peaks of weight. And one method suggests to report also the number, the ratio of cells activated over the 130 grams per centimeter. As you can see, the manual system has the higher weight on the seat. Very interesting is also the frequency at the electromyogram system. With the semi-automatic system, the driver is not involved in driving, so the muscular activation is very low. But this part of the analysis, the part related to the posture, is very interesting, because you can see in the semi-automatic driving, the neck and the head of the driver move in with a speed higher than in the other situation. All this test report that the semi-automatic position of the body is passive, so we have not the support of the wheel chair, of the wheel steering wheel. And for this reason,
I'm sorry, 2 minutes, less than 2 minutes.
Yes, yes. I go to the conclusion. In conclusion, two practical to practical conclusion of this work are very interesting, in my opinion, because when we have a semi-automatic system in the tractor, maybe we have to design also more comfort seat, because it's quite automatically that the speed is higher. But another very interesting conclusion is that in automatic system, the driver has not the support of the steering wheel. So maybe we can introduce a second armrest for the left arm. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Carlo, for your quite interesting presentation.
Sorry for the 10 minutes, but it's very big.
I would listen to you for minutes and minutes, but the time is very short. The organizer advised me that the time for the session is restricting. So from this time, if all the listeners of the attendants have questions, please put them into the chat. Now is the moment of the paper entitled Assessment of External Sprayer Cleaning Efficiency. I suppose that Marco Grella, Davide Allocchis, Paolo Marucco, and Paolo Balsari. I suppose that Paolo Marucco is presenting, the presentation. Good afternoon, Paolo. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Domenico, and good afternoon, everybody. So in this work, I will present some results about the assessment of efficiency of external cleaning sprayer devices. This operation of external cleaning is necessary, of course, to preserve the components of the sprayer, but also to prevent possible contamination for the operators and the environment. Typically, the point source pollution is generated during this kind of operation on the farmyard. We can use different cleaning systems for making this operation, and we can act on operating parameters as water pressure and water amount. And on the other hand, we can take into account the type of cleaning device and eventually the use of specific cleaning agents. But to date, very few scientific works are available. So our goal in this study was to evaluate the influence of the different parameters of external cleaning devices to assess the efficiency, their efficiency. And in particular, we examine different types of cleaning devices, different operating parameters. We looked also at different tank materials, and we compared also the different operators in making the operation to verify if there was any influence also due to the operator mode of action. We refer to the ISO 22368 Part 2 standard that defines the methodology to contaminate the sprayer with a solution of copper, with a water solution of copper oxychloride. Then we carried out the cleaning, and the tests were made indoor, so in under controlled environmental conditions, especially in terms of temperature and humidity. More in details, we can see here the steps of the test methodology used. So we contaminated the sprayer's external surface with 4 liters of this copper oxychloride solution using an absent sprayer. Then we washed the collection sheet that was placed around the sprayer with some clean water, and we collected the samples. Then we carried out the cleaning of the external surfaces of the sprayer using the cleaning devices. And again, we collected the samples. And finally, we rinsed the sprayer with a high pressure cleaner to remove all the residues, and also the waterproof sheet that was around the sprayer. And again, we collect samples. And finally, we made the analysis of the samples. So here you can see the layout of the test. We had this sprayer, mounted sprayer, typically used in vineyard, that was hanged on a hook, and was therefore suspended and surrounded by a PVC waterproof sheet in order to enable the collection of the cleaning washings. At the bottom of the PVC sheet, there was a drain hole to collect the samples. So both the contamination and the cleaning operation were carried out on the four sides of the sprayer in the position that are shown in this figure. So here you can see the three devices that we compared: spray gun, short spray gun, a long spray gun, what is typically called mitra in conventionally, then the spray lens, that also is another system that can be provided by the sprayers manufacturers. So the sterile contamination was carried out using an electric knapsack sprayer. And as mentioned, it was carried out working in the four different positions around the sprayer in order to contaminate it as even as possible. Then the PVC sheet was washed with clean water, just the PVC sheet, to remove, of course, the part of the spray mixture that was placed on the sprayer. And then the samples were analyzed, were collected, and therefore were successfully analyzed. The cleaning was carried out after 1 hour from the contamination, simulating a cleaning made just after the application, or after 24 hours, simulating a cleaning made the day after the application, for instance. It was used just an amount of water of 5 liters, taking into account what is the typical capacity of the clean water tank in equipped with the sprayer, so 10% of the nominal capacity of the main tank, and considering to use not more than 50% of this clean water to make the external cleaning. And then the samples of the washing liquid, of course, were collected and analyzed. Afterwards, the peroxychloride still present on the sprayer and eventually on the PVC sheet was removed with a high pressure cleaner at 150 bars using 24 liters of water. And then again, this liquid was collected and analyzed separately. So in total, we had about 11 samples for each single test replicate to be analyzed. And the analysis was made just weighing the samples after collection, and then after a period in oven at 105 degrees, 48 hours. So it was reweighed, and it was established the weight of the dry residue. Also, the operators were compared. So three different operators were instructed how to carry out the cleaning, and they were compared using the same spray cleaning device with the same operating parameters. And we carried out also some tests for comparing differences between a fiberglass tank and a polyethylene tank with the same capacity, that were characterized by different roughness of the surface. As you can see, the fiberglass tank was much smoother than the polyethylene one.
Sorry, Paolo, 2 minutes left.
Yes, I come straight to results. So concerning the influence of the cleaning devices, no statistical differences were found between the three systems, the three tools compared, even if a slight better results were obtained using the spray gun. When we used this spray gun with different operating parameters, we observed that best results were obtained using nozzles between 1.2 and 1.5 millimeter diameter, operated at 15 bar pressure. Using larger nozzles, we got the worst results, probably due to the fact that the time available for making the cleaning was very, very short. Concerning the difference between operators, we couldn't appreciate any significant differences. So the operator seemed to have no influence on the cleaning efficiency. While concerning the tank materials, as expected, the better cleaning efficiency was observed on the fiberglass. And again, it was evident that the cleaning efficiency was higher when using when making the cleaning just 1 hour after the contamination rather than 24 hours, because of course 24 hours was a long period to leave the residue get dry. So in general terms, we can say that the test results pointed out poor efficiency of these external cleaning devices, especially when a limited amount of water is available. So there is the need to develop more efficient systems. Higher cleaning efficiency were always achieved after 1 hour from the sprayer contamination, so enhancing the importance to carry out external sprayer cleaning right after the treatment. No significant differences were observed between the types of cleaning devices tested, even if slight better results were observed using the spray gun. Use of high pressures increased the cleaning efficiency, especially for medium-sized nozzles, and the best results was obtained with 1.2 nozzles operated at 1.5 megapascal. The cleaning efficiency was increased, of course, with on the tank with a smoother surface, so fiberglass in this case, and no significant differences were observed between the operators, thus highlighting that the methodology applied would be suitable to make also further tests and achieve repeatable results. So I thank you very much for your attention, and I am open for any questions if needed.
Thank you, Paolo, for your quite interesting, under my point of view, presentation dealing with a problem that normally is not sufficiently paid for attention. The washing of the sprayer at the end of the treatment is maybe a heavy problem. Okay, I repeat that if you have questions, please put them in the chat, because we have no time at the end of each presentation to be put on live mode. So we are passing to topic 6, safety, health and welfare in building. We have just one presentation titled Spatial Analysis to Assess the Availability of Sheet Wool as Potential Building Component by Monica Parlato, Francesca Valenti and Simona Maria Porto. I'm seeing that Monica Parlato and Francesca Valenti are present. Who of you is presenting? Monica Parlato. Monica, the floor is yours.
Really, the presentation is offline, but I'm staying here.
Okay.
Okay, don't worry.
If we can have a solution in the meantime, so because the time is short, we can postpone this presentation later and then pass quickly.
Okay.
Okay,
thank you so much.
For you. Thank you.
Yes, very much.
So let us know when you are ready. We are passing to topic 7, Agricultural 4.0 Automation, Remote Control, Robots and Innovative Vehicle. There is two different presentations. The first one is Smart Machinery and Devices for the Reduction of Risk for Human-Machine Interference by Pierluigi Rossi, Pierluigi Mangiavacchi, Danilo Monarchi and Massimo Cecchini. Pierluigi Rossi is presenting, but Massimo, I suppose that there is a video. Is it okay?
Hello everybody, I'm Pierluigi Rossi, safety engineer and a PhD student at Tuscia University in Viterbo. Today I will show you some highlights from a review article regarding smart solutions for reducing human-machine interference risks in agriculture. The simultaneous presence of autonomous agricultural vehicles and workers on foot can result in poor interaction between machines and operators. That's why the INAIL, which is the Italian Institute for Insurance Against Accidents at Work, funded a project called Smart Grid, which aims to develop a wireless infrastructure based on passive RFIDs and active Bluetooth BLE devices. Its purpose is the definition of a system which is capable of preventing hazards like runover, contact between workers on foot and tractor's equipment, or any contact between workers on foot and the tractor trails or towed equipment. Our first step in the project concerned the identification of any previous practical safety application involving smart devices or any other attempt to safely control an autonomous vehicle in agriculture. So we searched the Scopus database for any of those and we found 68 papers matching our searching criteria. Since the application fields resulted to be very broad, we further refined and selected the ones which helped us to identify particular strengths or weaknesses of a sensor or a wireless network. In this table, you can see the criteria that we choose for the Scopus search. Basically, we wanted to find any wireless application for safety purposes in agriculture and forestry. Great effort has been carried out, although, on any of the sectors we wanted to avoid. Same goes for the applications that are not part of the project, like emergencies or disaster management. This image, which has been generated with the R software package called Bibliometrics, shows the relationship among outdoor keywords, starting from the most used ones in the center. The most interesting feature that we can immediately see is that tractor safety is more linked to emergency notifications or control systems, which are something that most of the time are designed to work in cases of clear danger or accident. On the other hand, we can find IoT devices, artificial intelligence or cameras in association with accident prevention system, which is a completely different approach. This plot might better explain what we have previously seen. It is a matter of innovation that pushes safety to another level. Such newer devices can basically allow us to detect anomalies even when everything seems to be right. And that has a clear impact on research as well. This is the shortlist of the most important papers of the review. They are important because they describe a particular innovation or let us understand the limits of a particular wireless network. Here we can find the first attempt from Kubota in 1987 to control a tractor with a remote control and some extra automatic features that allowed to perform emergency stops in case of danger, or yet the first attempt to develop an emergency reporting system for rollovers in tractors, which started to show the importance of mobile phones as they are pretty much always present nearby the workers. Or another application, which is pretty much very low cost, from Rino Gubbiani, which integrates a Wiimote, basically a console joypad, in electrical chainsaws to detect anomalies, or a wireless video monitoring system, and yet again machine learning, which is artificial intelligence, which allows to detect the road in navigation systems for autonomous tractors. Here we can see three images from the previous papers. From 1987, the radio controller tractor from Kubota, which is a normal tractor that has been modified with some solenoid valves for acceleration, steering and braking, and an antenna on it for signal transmission. In 2009, this is a device which allows the driver of a tractor to understand if there are any kids nearby the tractor. And from 2013, Safe Driving is an application for mobile phones which simply detects any tractor rollovers and sends an emergency or report asking for help. From the analysis of the selected papers, we can find three fundamental aspects about safety design. They must be fault tolerant, they absolutely have to perform obstacle avoidance, and they might involve machine learning or any other artificial intelligence algorithm in order to improve the obstacle avoidance, because they can better understand both laser sensor and image processing from cameras. Let's spend now a couple words on emergency notification systems. Mobile phone applications can be of great help because they can send automatic alerts in case of accidents, and they are very reliable, and we can find them basically everywhere because everyone has it, so they don't need to rely on specific devices. Some other safety applications can rely on wireless networks in order to detect hazardous conditions or to reduce the workers' exposure to physical agents like noise and vibration. Even the IoT devices like Internet of Things can be a valuable instrument because they are easy and low cost, so they can use to detect any anomaly. Two are the main issues with such wireless devices, and they are connection issues and the lack of power. Connection issues might be solved in a couple of ways, because you can use aerial systems like drones, because they avoid the biggest trees and can allow to work on larger areas where other networks might fail. Another kind of solution is the use of passive modules or low energy modules, because they don't need any battery or require a small amount of energy. Another solution for larger fields is the Zigbee network, because it's like the wireless Wi-Fi network, but the devices do not require to be all connected to an access point. They can communicate with each other without it. We can draw some conclusions about design, the type of sensors or video capture devices, and wireless networks. About the design, we have to say that in order to operate an agricultural tractor remotely, it's important to develop emergency systems and to allow the tractor to operate in a condition that allows the operator to visually inspect what the vehicle is doing. About the sensors, cameras can provide artificial intelligence, so we can better understand what's going on around the vehicle, but they do not really work fine in bad weather conditions, while lasers, lidars or radars or any other kind of sensor can be combined to obtain an obstacle avoidance system, but they fail, on the other hand, to succeed in what cameras do, so they hardly can provide any understanding of the environment. About the wireless networks, the PESI wireless devices represent a reliable low-cost solution, while the Bluetooth offers greater device availability, since everyone has a mobile phone with it. Another important feature is the mesh networking, because it can overcome any issues concerning extreme distances from the so-called access point for Wi-Fi networks. Thanks for the attention. I'm here for any question.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the presentation, the video, of course. I do not see any comments or remark or question in the chat. So it's time to pass to the second paper of this topic seven. The paper is dealing with remote controls of solar dryer microplants for process standardization by Tiziana Maria Piera Cattaneo, Carlo Bisaglia, Alessandro Cammerata, Anna Maria Stellari, Ilio Romano. I suppose that Tiziana Cattaneo is presenting. Is it correct?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Tiziana. The floor is yours.
Can you see me and hear me?
Yes, of course. Perfect.
Of course.
Presentation mode.
Thank you, John. So just a few words to introduce myself, because I working at the Research Center for Engineering and Agrofood Processing in Milan. And our mission is to study the second part of the food value chain, so from post-harvest to fork. This is very important because we in general speak about precision agriculture. In this case, we try to apply the definition precision agrofood system of processing. So we choose renewable energy on the basis of the need nowadays to use new or renewable forms of energy. Solar energy is very interesting, but if we use solar energy for food transformation directly, we have some problem, pollutants, insects, animals, and also wind, sand, and so on. But using the plant, the dehydration plant based on solar energy, we can avoid this problem. So we try to control, to monitor the efficiency on two different types of solar dryer. With using very simple methodologies, sensors for the monitoring of these drying processes. This is the two microplant. The material is polycarbonate thanks to its very high specific surface. And the two principles are that M1 works as a mild oven. This fan up the microplant is activated only in the temperature range from 35-45 degrees and then stop on the basis of the detection of the internal temperature. The second one simulated the natural and traditional way to dehydrate food. So there is just on the bottom a fan that falls outside the humid air. Other sensors are positioned on the bottom. You can see here this black paper. It's not a paper, it's a balance to monitor the weight loss, the change in weight during the hydration. So if we schematize this different position and sensor, we try to record many parameters outside, light, temperature and humidity. Sorry, this is fun, not phone. and because it's active here, the other fan is there, and also the two trays positioned to evaluate if there were some differences between the up part and the down part inside the microplant. Then the weight here, and inside also temperature and humidity. So we try to dehydrate the eggplant slices, but in this case, we just speak about the plants. So also the raw material were arranged inside the two different microplants side by side in parallel to avoid other problems, variabilities. As independent variables, it's clear sensor and the side, but fan, temperature, relative humidity and weight were dependent variable. Okay, we use for fan at internal temperature, Arduino sensor and Arduino Mega to control the activation of fan. For the other parameters, we use in continuous to receive in remote on our computer, on the smartphone, the parameters such as relative humidity, temperature external and internal, and so on, Arduino UN. And the fan was controlled by Arduino One. So I reported just the definition of the different parameters controlled. You surely know very well. And then we have normalized data to have all the variables in this general plot. You can see that we have times and hour, and M1 is the first plant, M2 the second plant, the external, the climate condition in external. So if tried to monitor and control and also elaborate the processing the results about the differences, and you can with the measures between sites and so on, and you can see that the fan, the red one, is only for controlled in M1, because in M2 fan is continuously active to force outside the air. So we have here fan is on or off if temperature is outside the two limits. So also the relative humidity have different trend in the two dryers, in external during the night and during the day. So we can comment that the temperature reached in the natural dehydration plan with the fan for a constant number of revolution is more dependent on the external temperature, of course. During the hottest hour of the day, reaches higher levels than M1, because in M1, the fan was programmed to counteract thermal excesses. And the constant activity in the second microplan allowed the reduction of the relative humidity during the night, that was not contrasted in M1 because the fan was inactive during the night. So we can see the fan. This is by each parameters. P is weight, and there is the decrease of weight as a trend. But of course, during the night, we have a radar hydration of the product, because the humidity and temperature are not comparable with the temperature during the day. So
just 2 minutes, sorry.
Okay, inside we have temperature in the two plant with no big differences, and also up and down inside the same plant was very similar. The weight loss trend showed after the night humidity highlight an increase of the weight recorded during the night, but we didn't find statistical significant differences between upper and lower area inside the dryer with the active fan. So the two processes in any case were efficient. Both microplan worked to reach a good level of dehydration. They chose simple methodology very suitable to monitoring continuous the dehydration process or the environmental. It's clear that the choice of their use is strictly related to our objective. You can choose to have more standardized processes using M1 or more natural processes using M2. Food safety is also assured because we monitor also the water activity, and the critical value of water activity is 0.6. So all in all part of this plant was lower than. I wanted to thank in particular the technical staff in Treviglio for their support, my university, our founder, but all of you, all the attendees. Thanks.
Thank you, Tiziana. I suppose that eggplants are on fire this afternoon after the presentation of John Roskranz, also Tiziana Cattaneo, deal with these plants. Okay. Now we come back to the topic six because Monica Parlato is ready for your presentation. I remember the title, Spatial Analysis to Assess the Availability of Sheep Wool as Potential Building Components. Monica Parlato, Francesca Valenti and Simona Maria Porto. Monica, to you.
Let's go. So the title, as you say, is Spatial Analysis to Assess the Availability of Sheep Wool as Potential Eco-Friendly Material. And this project
moved from the big issues concerning agriculture.
No, sorry. Is the last presentation. Okay. Is the presentation that I recorded before. So in this case, I shut up and we can go with the presentation recorded if you are agree. Okay, perfect.
To move from the big issues concerning agricultural waste and their continuous growing and their potential reuse in accordance with the circular economy statement and new green deal agenda to obtain a new resource for green building material. A potential reuse of agricultural waste is based on a correct disposal of management and on their availability. So in this study was implemented a geographical information system based model to assess the considered waste, for instance, sheep wool in a region, Sicily, with a high concentration of this kind of breeder. In fact, in Italy, Sicily is the second region for number of sheep after Sardinia, with almost 900,000 of animals. For the current law, sheep wool is considered a special waste for its high potential bacterial load with high disposal cost for breeder. For this reason, often wool is improperly disposed of, burned or buried, with serious consequence for environmental pollution concerning air quality and soil. But on the other hand, thanks to its behavior, the reuse of greasy wool could reduce both environmental pollution and energy consumption, and sheep wool could become a resource for green building material, if valorized, of course, to attain a material fully complying with eco-friendly construction criteria. In fact, wood is suitable for thermal and acoustical building insulation. In fact, wool is considering the most performant natural thermal insulation material. Wool is a material with a high elasticity, a good tensile strength, and an elevated hygroscopicity, and a good fire resistance. So the really question is if it's correct considering wool as a waste or if it's a resource. Moreover, by considering rural buildings, the use of wool as insulation materials could improve the control of microclimatic condition that is of relevant importance during the agro-industry process. For instance, we can think to buildings for intensive animal breeding without a correct insulation, thermal insulation, that could avoid effect as it stress for animals. Or we can think of olive mills, winery, flour mill, where the temperature control is of relevant importance for all the process. Moreover, sheep wool, thanks a chemical process, is suitable to absorb dangerous substances such as nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, toluene, and formaldehyde. These characteristics to improve indoor air quality, important for human and or animal wellness. In this study, a three-step approach was carried out. The first step was about the preparation of data for GIS-based implementation and analysis. Data were supplied by National Zootechnical Registry of Health Ministry. The second step was about the implementation of GIS model. And the first step was about the realization of a tailored map about the quantification and location of the yearly sheep wool fiber production. Okay, in this slide, we have some preliminary results. So results show that the province with the higher quantity of sheep is Palermo. The second are Agrigento and Enna, and the last Siracusa and Ragusa. These two last provinces are the province with the highest concentration of protected crops. So with the few free areas suitable for breeder, and also for the morphology of territory. In this slide, we have a distribution within Sicily region of sheep wool and as potentially resource for eco-friendly material. Also in this case, the province with the highest quantity of wool are Palermo, Agrigento, and Enna, and the province with the lower quantity of sheep for each year are Ragusa and Siracusa. The consideration was that each sheep produce each year a quantity of 1 kilo of wool. If we consider 900,000 sheep in Sicily, we can affirm that each year the total production of wool of unused wool is around 1,000 tons. These are preliminary results that could be used for planning future collection center by paying attention to the transport cost during the logistic and supply phase. For instance, for the distance between the breeder area and the future and this future collection center. Center with the scope to reduce environmental pollution, social impacts, also on landscape, obviously, and cost. In the next future, in order to convert this waste in a real resource, could be useful to improve cooperation between breeders, for instance, to implement a pre-sharing wash phase between waste collector, transporter, and recycler to ensure the maximum amount of this waste, sheep wool, recovery, and reuse. At the end, a life cycle assessment to investigate the sustainability of the wool process should be also implemented.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry for the
inconvenience. No, don't worry. All was okay. Thank you very much for your video presentation. A question. I put a question in the chat, but Monica, you can answer in the chat at any time you want.
Okay, thank you.
The time is quite brief, so I pass to the last topic for this session, topic 8, noise, vibration, dust, endotoxin, and microorganisms. We have five presentations about this topic. The first one is entitled Dynamic Characteristics of Seeds Equipping Old Tractors by Christian Preti, Roberto Deboli, and Angela Calvo. Christian Preti is presenting. And Monica, you can close your presentation, unshare the screen. Thank you. Christian, the floor is yours. I suppose okay. You are presenting live.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. In this paper, I'm going to talk about the dynamic characteristics of the seed, equipping old agricultural tractor. Italy has one of the largest agricultural tractor fleets in the world and one of the lowest ratio tractor worked hectares. Each farmer so has his own underused old tractor that is often more than 25 years old. And the seat of an agricultural tractor is one of the most wearing and expensive elements. And it has a lower duration than the machine. The market offers cheap seat model for used agricultural machine, but many farmers prefer to repair the seat themselves and replace the worn parts. Agricultural tractors are equipped with a suspension seat that provides a substantial reduction of vibration, improving the driver's comfort. But the correct choice of the seat plays a significant role to minimize the vertical vibration transmitted to the tractor driver by the tractor. Their efficiency depends on many variables, the dynamic of the seat, the frequency of the input vibration, the characteristics of the human body, especially the mass. The seat is composed by a metal frame with spring, foam, and dampers. The spring damper system is not hermetically sealed under the seat, and for this reason, it's exposed to the dust and the dirt that compromise its functionality. When replacing the workpiece, farmer only consider the physical sides of the damper to be replaced and don't worry about its damping characteristics. However, incorrect choice of damper may compromise the functionality of the seat. The goal statement of this work was to perform resonant tests to investigate the dynamic characteristic of a seat using a set of dampers with different diameters of the internal hole. The damper has a piston that moves inside a sealed oil-filled cylinder during the movement of the seat. The oil flows through the cylinder from one chamber to another by a little control hole and one-way valves. The diameter of the hole of the dampers tested in this work were 0.1, 0.13, 0.15, 0.18, 0.21, and 0.25 millimeter. But the damper have the same volume of the chambers and the same length and diameter of the pistons. All tests for determining the damping characteristics in the resonance range were conducted in accordance with the Council Directive 78-764, the Annex 14, that talking about the seat. The damping test includes two steps: research the resonant frequency of the suspension and calculating the transmissibility of the suspension at the resonant frequency. The seat was loaded with a ballast of 40 kilograms first, and then with a 80 kilogram mass. Sinusoidal oscillation at different frequencies, plus or minus 15 millimeter of amplitude, were generated to the bench to find out the resonant frequency. The applied frequency started from 0.5 Hertz up to the highest frequency where the seat did not hit the limit stop pad. We use the bench that is located at the STEM CNR laboratories in Turin that is able to simulate the vertical vibration in the driver seat fixing point. And the vibrations are generated by an electro-hydraulic device by MTS. We use two ICP accelerometers from PCB with 100 millivolt per G of sensitivity. And we acquire the signal and store it on a laptop using a national instrument data acquisition card. And later we process the data using AlaView software. The RMS value of the weighted seat vibration acceleration, AVUS, and the RMS value of the weighted vibration acceleration at the seat attachment on the bench were simultaneously acquired. Their measurement of each frequency was approximately of 60 seconds. The efficiency of each damper was evaluated by the seat effective amplitude transmissibility, SEAT value. The SEAT was calculated at interval of 0.1 Hertz. On the bench, the acceleration always increase with the increasing frequency, with a constant rate of increase, regardless of the mass of the ballast. On the seat, the acceleration growth is inversely proportional to the diameter of the hole in the damper. This is mostly evident with the ballast of 80 kilograms. The stepness is not always rising. With the ballast of 40 kilograms, the decrease is mostly evident in the hole of 0.25 millimeter and 0.18 millimeter after 1.5 Hertz. With the 80 kilogram ballast, the slope decreases after 1.5 Hertz in all the damper, except the smallest one, the 0.1 millimeter and 0.13 millimeter damper holes. In this figure, it's possible to see how much the damper with the hole of 0.25 millimeter and the ballast of 40 kilograms is critical. Between 1.3 and 2.1 Hertz, the seat is always higher than one. What does it mean? It means that the seat does not reduce the vibration coming from the platform. So this table shows the calculated seat SEAT value with the tested dampers in function of the frequency. Green data means that the seat reduces the vibration coming from the bench when the SEAT is less than one. yellow value correspond to a seat value higher than one, while red cell indicate the resonance point. Critical data are more often present with a 40 kilogram ballast, where the resonance appear at 1.6, 1.7, and 2 hertz. This is the unique case produced by the 0.1 millimeter hole damper. With the 80 kilogram ballast, the resonance is at 1.2, 1.4 4 hertz, except the 0.1 millimeter hole damper. Dampers so work better with the heavier ballast, except the damper with a 0.1 millimeter hole. Higher is the damper of the hole damper. Higher is the diameter of the hole damper, lower is the seat value at the frequency higher than 2 hertz.
2 meters, Christian, 2 minutes.
Okay, this is my conclusion. In conclusion, with the 40 kilogram ballast, the resonance is at 1.6, 1.7 hertz. With the 80 kilogram ballast, the resonance is instead in the range of 1.2, 1.4 4 hertz. The only exception is the damper with the smallest hole, 0.1 millimeter, that show the resonance at 2 and 2.5 hertz respectively. The SEAT parameter represent the efficiency of the seat isolation and therefore the efficiency of the damper. A seat value lower than one means that the seat reduced the vibration coming from the platform. In this work, all the tested dampers showed a seat value higher than one with a ballast of 40 kilogram and starting from 1.3 hertz. The seat value were, however, closer to one with a ballast of 80 kilograms. Dampers works better with a heavier ballast, except the damper with a 0.1 millimeter hole. So it's important to train the farmer to a correct seat weight adjustment, but is otherwise important to sensitize them to a correct maintenance of the shocks absorber. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Christian, for our, for me, quite interesting presentation dealing with the performance of the, okay, the seat suspension and the condition of maintenance of these seats also, not only in the suspension system, but all in the other parts.
Yeah.
Okay, quickly to the second paper about topic 8, a paper entitled "How much are the hand arm vibration and noise level generated by chainsaw used at small scale forestry?" by Salvatore Francesco Papandrea, Andrea Rosario Proto, Stefano Grigolato, Raffaele Cavalli and Giuseppe Zimbalatti. I suppose Dr. Papandrea is introducing this presentation, this paper, is it okay?
Okay, good afternoon, everyone.
Okay, Salvatore, to you.
I send you my oral presentation, but I didn't receive your email. I try share with you my video.
Okay. Is a video or a PPT presentation?
No, only video.
Okay. Proceed.
Good afternoon. I am Papandrea Salvatore, a PhD student at the Agriculture Department of Reggio Calabria in South Italy, and I would like to present this research work entitled "How much are the hand arm vibration and the noise level generated by chance and use at small scale forestry?" In small scale forest management, usually related to smaller cultural forest farm, the forest work system is a convergent semi-mechanized, and it represents only a part of the annual work of the operators. Small farm participation in commercial food market could potentially make a major contribution to rural economic growth and the achievement of ecosystem objective. In Italy, as in many European countries, farm forest is widely recognized for increasing and diversifying farm productivity while releasing pressure of extinction forests. Small-scale forest management represents an important resource that offers alternative and a more sustainable way of exploiting the land in era that are not completely booted, particularly in typical underdevelopment era with a low level of mechanization. Often, the chance sound used by the operator usually are all manufactured and unlike large forest companies. Workers in small forest companies very often don't take care of the maintenance of their chainsaw. For example, maintenance, lubrication, and checking of tension the chain, occasional engine maintenance, and this affect both the performance and the safety of the operator. For all these reasons, chainsaw are still students in Italy and specific training programs are developing to improve operator safety. The Public Health and Safety Unit also focused its attention in the use of the PPE and the major drawbacks related to the use of chainsaw. In fact, the use of chainsaw exposes operator to many risks, example, having diseases, vibration stresses, dust and exhaust gas. This work aims to investigate the current level of vibration and noise to winch operators are exposed when using chainsaw of some year old and some cases with poor maintenance. During the test, the operator made travel cuts with each of the tested chainsaw on the prepared wood logs. Tests were carried out in South Italy and the site was equipped with saw logs of beech and saw logs of Corsican pine. Chainsaw were handled by the same forest worker with high training level and experience. A control test was conducted, maintaining the same moisture content and diameter and the same operator. Specific tools were used to collect data. For vibration, one vibrometer delta ohm, two triaxial accelerometers, one calibrator portable delta ohm. For the noise, one phonometer delta ohm, one sound level calibrator. The instruments used are in accordance with the regulation enforced in Italy regarding mechanical vibration and electroacoustics. For this study, 9 different chainsaws were used, not of the last generation, which therefore have not had good maintenance in recent years. As shown the table, very old and more recent chainsaws were evaluated. For example, the Steel MS-461 produced in the year 2015. In this study, several variables were evaluated, including 9 different chainsaw used at 3 different engine acceleration speed, minimum engine power for each reps, maximum engine power for each reps, maximum engine power during cross cut for each reps. They have also been considered 2 different positions of accelerometer, were used to acquire the vibration from front and the back position, and 2 different wood type, hardwood, European beech, and softwood, Corsican pine. As for the result, the highest value for total vibration were found with the chainsaw model D when cutting the both species. In almost all of the chainsaw models tested, the vibration were concentrated mainly in the rear. Only the F and the high model had a similar average value between the front and the rear vibration. From the statistical analysis, it emerged that the species was not a factor that has statistically significant effect on vibration. as well the type of the chanson and the data detection position. As regards the study on noise, the results were quite different from each other RNA, except for the some case. Generally, very different values were not recorded during the cuts on the two different wood species. ANOVA was also conducted for noise among the factory examined. As for the vibration, also in the case of noise, the wood species was a factor that had no statistically significant effect on the result obtained, while the type of the chanson presented p-value lower than 0.05. As can be seen from the table, the difference cannot be attributed to the age of the chanson, since the old production chanson did not show statistical different results from those with more modern models. Probably the reason for this difference concerns the maintenance level of the instrument, which certainly not only influences its efficiency, but also influences the level, the vibration, and the noise that it develops. This graph shows the upper and the lower limit from Rothsteiner et al. 2012 on a new chanson with the same type of the chain and the bordering control test three different wood species, poplar, spruce, and beech. Comparing the limits with the value of our study, we see how only a chanson produced in the year 2012 significantly exceeded the upper limit. Even the oldest chansons are borderline with the upper limit. Maintenance and the state of preservation play a key role. At no professional level, this is the lack of information which translates into greater risks for operator and if they work optionally. In future research, it would be interesting to repeat this experiment in other three species, work phase, chance type, as well as professional operator. The results of this work should be interpreted as being indicative as they account for descriptive test study, which can prove its utility and replicability in similar conditions in an agroforest farm in which the use of the chanson is low frequent. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Salvatore, for your presentation, your video, of course, this dealing with a very heavy problem about noise, but above all, vibration using chainsaw. Also in non-professional condition means that also probably the maintenance is not so good about the chainsaw and other tools used by hand. Okay, we have one question in chat. So Salvatore, you are invited to answer in chat also. We can pass quickly to the next presentation, comparison of whole body vibration exposure between quarry and farm activities by Massimo Cecchini, Danilo Monarca, Andrea Colantoni, Filippo Cossio, Guido Alfaro De Gan, Gianluca Coltrinari. I suppose that Gianluca Coltrinari, of course, is introducing and launching the video. Is it correct?
Good evening. Thank you for your attention. I'm asking about the problem of the whole body vibration for the vehicles and the quarry activities and farm activities.
Morning, I'm Gianluca Coltrinari of the University of Tuscia from Viterbo, and I'm going to present to you my work about the comparison of the whole body vibration exposure for the driver in the quarry and the farm activities. Farm tractors contribute to some of the problem for the workers' health hazards during the daily activities because the tractors are a source of high vibration levels, especially during different operation in the farm. The same problem is present in the quarry activities during the production process, where specific machinery and vehicles are employed. The boundary condition influences strongly the exposure, for example, the ground conditions. Another example is the loud LHD, load haul dump vehicles, that represent a specific potential dangerous source of hazard ill to human due to many factors, because during the travel the driver is exposed to high level vibration generated by road terrain, heavy loading and haul travels. The whole body vibration is characterized by multiple shocks that can generate negative effects on the lumbar spine of the drivers. The same problem is present in the farm activities, where the use of different equipment for the tractors affect whole body vibration exposure and generate high level vibration that can lead to negative effects on the workers' health. Various studies confirm that the long-term whole body vibration exposure can generate negative effects and particularly a low back pain of the driver. The effect of the whole body vibration exposure are different. For example, fatigue, lower back pain, problem to the spinal region, vision problems, and many other negative effects. In particular, the exposure effects depend to many factors: magnitude of the waveform, the driver's position, the ground condition in the farm and in the quarry, the worker's anthropometric characteristics, and the exposure time for the occupant during the daily activities, the types of vehicle, the speed of vehicles inside the quarry site or in the farm. But the most relevant problem is that analog epidemiological evidence to outline a clear relationship there is not yet, and the health disorders are not connected to the really exposure of the driver. In order to assess the whole body vibration exposure, the international standard show the measure methods and indicates a health caution zone for a definite time. The time is defined by 8 hours, and furthermore, it's necessary to point out that low back disorders are generated in the particular context of the farm for the ground condition, and in the quarry side also for the same problem, the ground condition. This fact is very important because the highest level of the vertical vibration for values more of 0.5 meters per second can generate relevant disorders. In this paper we have realized the two different campaigns. The first one was realized in limestone quarry 100 far away from Rome, and the measurement of whole body vibration were realized on the 4 different typical quarry machineries. The first one excavator, the second one jeep, the third puncher machine, and load haul dump truck. In the second measurement campaign, the same measurement were realized in the university in the specific farm with the same border condition on different types of tractors: New Holland, John Deere, and another type of New Holland tractor. The vibration data were measured on the driver's seat. The instrument was fixed on the driver's seat and fixed by snap. The instrument is fixed along a specific duration, X, Y, and Z, and the sampling frequency and the range measurement were defined before the start of the measurement. The parameter that represent the exposure for the drivers is reported in the following picture, and it's defined by the specific exposure standard international, and it represent the effective exposure for the drivers, and it define the time of exposure and acceleration along the max duration height values. The values of acceleration are corrected by a constant factor, 1.4, and we can see here the result for each machinery. First one, the pincer machinery, we can see here the time history with the relative frequency spectrum, and we can see here the effects of the digging holes operation. For the excavator, we can see the same graphs, time history and frequency spectrum with the phase of engine power regime minimum. Load haul dump truck, time history and frequency spectrum, we can see here, sorry, loading material, dumping material, and the effect of load of a big rock on the dump. Another effects we can see here, the same effects for the tractor John Deere in the farm measurement campaign. This is the time history of the operation cutoff greenery and the relative effects of the hard plant and the frequency spectrum. At the same time, we can see here the time history of the tractor John Deere during a tillage operation and the frequency spectrum. And finally, we can see that during the measurement campaign, we can see that the vertical vibration is the direction that dominates all the measurements. This result has been attained for the tractors and for all the vehicles in the quarry site. The instantaneous peak acceleration and the dominant frequency are defined in a specific range of values. Particularly, the dominant frequency are starting from 1.3 Hz until 6 Hz for the tracks. For the tractors measurement and for the quarry vehicles measurement. Field data collection occurred in both experimental campaign shows many similar results. It's necessary to point out that for both measurement campaigns the boundary conditions are similar, but for the tractors the specific task influences strongly the real world body vibration exposure for the driver. The measurement was repeated for the same driver on the different vehicles in the measurement campaign of the quarry site and in the farm measurement campaign, and the exposure dose values is influenced strongly by the time exposure and the signal of and the intensity of the vibration signal of each vehicle for the tractors and for machinery vehicles. Furthermore, we can see that as above that the tractor's exposure is strongly influenced by the specific task, and in order to reduce the whole body vibration exposure for the drivers, we can think about change the machinery and scheduling the drivers' activities with extra pauses
in order to reduce the effective time exposure. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Gianluca, and other authors, of course, for this interesting presentation. I note that the core activity and the cultural activity are very similar in vibration level, so underlining that agricultural activity is quite heavy and comparable to quarry activity that normally is considered a very heavy activity, working activity. That's right. Okay. Quickly to the next presentation, I'm seeing Rino Gubbiani also ready to present the paper analysis of mechanical vibration generated by tractors, human body absorption in drivers with different body mass index. The authors other than Rino Gubbiani, Nicola Zucchiatti, Ugo D'Abroi, Carlo Moreschi. Rino, the floor is yours. I suppose you are presenting in live.
Yes. good evening at all. I condividi, vediamo se va. Okay, you can see?
Perfect.
Okay. So I have seen the past presentation, but I do a little introduction. So a great deal of research has been conducted to measure the levels of whole body vibration to which tractor drivers are subject during agricultural activity. And as far as the whole body is concerned, the risk it relates to an increase in the occurrence of disorder and injuries on the lumbar spine. This is a big problem, we know. So we know because we are some old, and so when past 50 years, all we have some lumbar spine problems. So in the agricultural checksum, in particular, vibration between 2 and 10 hertz are indubitably the higher level of the therefore most damaging, also because of their specific danger. Fortunately, the wallets in vibration database do not take environment condition into account. The different characteristics of the road surface, the speed of travel, tape condition of the set, etc., all have a strong and varying effect on the exposure levels produced by machine, even if they are at the same time. So the amount of vibration absorbed, acceleration imparted to surface body tissues, and consequently also to the deep body tissues, increase with the speed of the vehicle. This is found in a lot of research. The vibration and the acceleration of the tissues at pelvis level are affected by a decreasing share naturally by the low density soft tissue of the gluteal region, adipose and muscle tissues, then transmitted to the lumbosacral bone structure, and finally to the cervical dorsal bone structures, to which an additional share comes from the upper limbs, from the steering wheel, stroke the hands, forearm, arm, shoulder. So why this research? Because in viticulture, we have a new demand for new tractors. The tractors are request a high forward speed for decreased transport time and displacement. And this means, of course, more speed, more vibration, more working time for reduced fixed cost. The agricultural driver not works only 88 hours, but often 10, 12, depending on season, of course. Possibility to operating with different machine, front or rear attached. Of course, often we use two equipment in the same tractor. Very large offer of models, narrow tractors, tool carriers, half crawler, over-the-road tractor, self-propeller, as a harvester. This, of course, complicated the analysis of vibration. Objective of this work is the aim of this work was to evaluate the level of vibration produced by different types of tractors, also utilized with different operating machine connected, and the magnitude of vibration impacting the whole human body, specifically from the bony structures and the pelvis and spine, in case of drivers with different body mass index, okay? The assumption is the vibration are better transmitted in a rigid part, same as bones, than in softer part, fat mass. So the project is to test its transmission in the human body with respect to the physical structure. The present study is to be supplanted with measuring on drivers with overweight, BMI 24, major 24.9, or underweight body condition in order to assess to extend to which the adipose and muscular tissue in the gluteal region can attenuate the absorption of vibration acceleration, of course, in the pelvis and influence their transmission to the ideal region of spinal column. So, Okay. The test followed two methodologies. One survey sheet of all parameters to find population difference between linear tractors. We have a questionnaire about tractors, brand, power, age, hours, model, gearbox, type, structure, suspension cap, seat, tires, worn, speed, and so on. Cultivation, variety, dimension, of vineyard, soil condition, track condition, slope, operation, type of operation, machinery used in operation, models, kind of attack, mounted trailer, and also worker, gender, tall, weight, BMI of workers. Second test with two tractors, one obsolete and one new, and with four different drivers, three different speed, 2, 6, 10 kilometers per hour, three different BMI, two gender, normal men, slim men, fat men, and also we like one woman. Three different position to measuring, SEAT, lumbosacral, cervical, dorsal junction. We not do this because so it's still work in progress because about COVID-19 and difficult to find these different driver with qualification drivers for the tractor. Now, not easy to find all. Okay. This is, for example, the all the questionnaire, what the sum is an abstract about all variables you wave found. This is instrumentation for measurements, accelerometer and calibrator, phonometer and calibrator, etc. is normal, okay. Results, this is, for example, we measured the various operations in viticulture and now measuring harvesting operation with the grape harvester and transport trailers. Not all the tests carried out are shown in the graph or easy for reading because too long, but we can defoliation, fertilization, flamer, shredding, soil working, etc. And so in the graph about the right side, show the sum of the RMS for the three axles, X, Y, and Z. And you can see some of the tractors. You can see in general some overcome 0.5 meters per second squared of acceleration stability to be able to work 80 hours. You can see here, okay. And so this another this is a kind of scheduler, yes. Oh, I have still finished. We have time. We here two examples of sheet. We have time. Okay. I pass in others. Okay. For example, this graph show the test made with a tractor with an undamped seat and under the safety frame with a normal person. Okay. It can be that the vibration in zeta axis in Z are very high and due for the type of terrain and cultivated field and dirty road. You can see Z so high, okay? This is another tractor equipped with a Kishinot fab and mechanical seat with parallelogram suspension. We can see the decrease of contribute of Z axis, okay? And this is, this is, for example, a frequency analysis. You can see.
No, sorry, 1 minute.
Yeah. We can see the frequency is about 2.4 hertz, okay? No, and so this interesting in this, I see this, the difference to old tractor and the new tractor is only Z, because you can see the contribution of the arms on the steering wheel is very high. You can see the X and X and Y don't decrease if compared to the old tractor. The old tractor is a Fiat 680, is about 40 years old, okay? This is new, but the problem is the E, Y, and X components increase due to rolling, pitch, and serpentine movements. So the new C decrease only Z axis, okay? And of course, conclusions. This is a work in progress, and with the collaboration of the doctors, we collaborate with our medical staff, we are trying to get the relationship machinery type of driver. The idea is also to obtain a model that allows use on the basis of the BMI of each person to see the vibrational limits to which they can be subjected in function of the different machines. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Rino, for your presentation, for the work, quite interesting, for the data, for the many data presented. And also for an aspect detail that normally is not sufficiently considered, that is BMI of the driver, that we know that agricultural workers are normally have a high BMI. And so this is a question that it's quite important and normally is not sufficiently considered, okay? In this case, last but not least, of course, we are to the last presentation, right? The last presentation of today, of this session. The title is We Are Changing, Not Vibration, but Noise, but Dust. Abatement System Efficiency Comparison of PM, Particulate Matter, Emitted by Biomass Combustion by Andrea Colantoni, Enrico Paris, Monica Carnevale, Beatrice Vincenti, Adriano Palma, Leonardo Bianchini, Francesco Gallucci. I suppose is Enrico Paris presenting. I don't know if he will present live or a video.
Yes, I present live.
Massimo is introducing, not Enrico Paris. So, okay, Massimo, to you for the video, I suppose. Okay, Enrico, are you sharing or Massimo?
No, I can sharing if you want. Okay. Just a second. I switch off the camera because there is a bad connection. Okay.
Yeah.
So, good evening. This work was realized at the Laserbeam Laboratory of CREATE in collaboration with the University of Tusha. Among the various renewable sources, the energy conversion of biomass makes it possible to obtain energy from naturally and cyclically bioavailable waste products. Combustion is a phenomenon that inevitably generates particulate matter, and therefore this also occurs in the case of biomass combustion. In this work, the difference in terms of PM emitted and environmental impact between controlled and uncontrolled biomass combustion was studied. By uncontrolled combustion, we mean all those phenomena defined as open burning that lead to the consumption of biomass without abatement system. For example, the use of domestic fireplace or combustion of prunning in an open field. These phenomena generate large quantities of particulate matter, of PM, which have a dangerous impact on the atmosphere. In this work, several fruit tree prunnings were used for the tests. These biomass were used in different boilers with a different abatement system. In the first boiler that you can see here, we simulated the open burning process because this boiler is without any abatement system. The data obtained from this one were compared with those obtained from these other two. The first one, this one, the second one is equipped with a multi-cyclonic filter only, and the second one was equipped by a cyclonic filter and a back filter. During combustion, as an isocinetic sampling probe was used in the stack, and it made it possible to sample the APM generated, which was subsequently determined gravimetrically. An Ariba PG 250 multiparameter detector made it possible to continuously monitor the composition of emitted gases, and the oxygen content was used to normalize the results obtained on different boilers. And the results, you can see, by standardizing and normalizing the results, it was possible to compare the quantity of PM released with and without abatement system. It is evident that open burning, the first two columns, is a phenomenon that generates large quantities of particulate matter, therefore a dangerous result for the areas and the neighbor population to the phenomenon of combustion. The use of a multi-cyclonic filter allows a reduction of the PM generated, while the last two columns, the exploitation of a two abatement system that is multi-cyclonic at back filter allows to significantly reduce the PM emitted. The red line represents the limit imposed by legislation in Italy for emission from small boilers. In conclusion, the use of biomass boilers with adequate abatement systems allows to obtain an efficient energy conversion from agroforestry waste products that otherwise risk being burned in the open field or being involved in fires, a process that have a high atmospheric impact. Further studies and research should be carried out to develop and test more advanced dedicated abatement systems. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Enrico. You you were the last presenting, but the quickest. So many, many thanks to you, because in this case we have the chance to finish in time the session, a long session. 12 presentation, all the authors and speakers were present. I thank you, we all thank them, thank you very much for quite interesting presentation dealing with very, very various topics.
Thank you.
I thanks again, not only the speaker and authors, but also the attendants. And now it's time just to move to room 2 for the closure session. Have a nice evening to all of you.